Canada has been referred to as a melting pot and is well known for its diverse cultural mosaic. But those born after the Second World War may be surprised to learn that this is a more recent development. Although Canada fought against the Nazis, its record on racism before and during that time is not without its blemishes. This was a very different time, and many Western nations, citizens, and governments were susceptible to racist sentiment and actions. Canada was no different. Immigration policy was not always welcoming, and the Canadian citizens were, in general, protectionist and looked at non-Christian European and Japanese immigrants as well as the Indigenous First Nations peoples as second-class citizens. They were met with discrimination in many ways, and for the Jews of Western Europe seeking refuge from Hitler in Germany and the Bolsheviks in Russia during the 1930s, their call was not answered. Refused entry into Canada as well as many nations in the world, they were left to their fates in the impending Holocaust. As the severity of the tragedy that faced the Jews increased, the immigration numbers to Canada decreased.
Well, part of it was economic, and that was that Canada was one of the countries most gravely affected by the economic depression. And a lot of it was just racism, the feeling that, and it's insane because the Jews have been a part of our culture right from the beginning. But there's a feeling they weren't quite part of the Anglo-French culture that made up the country.
In the early 20th century, Canada had a separate category of immigrants called non-preferred immigrants. This category included Jews, Orientals, and Blacks, and they were expected to remain out of sight and take the least desirable of jobs. As a result of the 1929 economic depression, unemployment had reached unprecedented levels. The restrictions on immigration were tightened and were to effectively ban all non-agricultural immigrants. Those allowed in were given a one-year probationary period, after which, if they had not secured employment or were deemed otherwise undesirable, they would be deported. German Jews seeking refuge from their plight were in an unfortunate situation because Canada could not deport them after the probation period because they had become effectively stateless. The situation arose in 1933 when Hitler decreed that German Jews were to no longer be granted consular services outside of Germany, and following the Nuremberg Laws of 1935, they stopped issuing Jews passports. Those who already had passports would receive the letter J stamped on them and were informed that they were welcome to leave Germany with them, but not to return. Anti-Semitism and racism, in general, were not confined to Germany. Even Canada's Prime Minister, William Lyon Mackenzie King, was recorded as having racist sentiments.
Yeah, in the Mackenzie King diary, he notes that a new family had moved in on Laurier Avenue in Ottawa near his house. And he said, you know, they seem to be lovely people. And then he adds, but I hope not too many more of them come into the neighborhood. The awful fact is Canada was typical. Terribly typical. There was a strong strain of anti-Semitism in the West. And unfortunately, this is one of the elements that unites French and English culture in Canada. It's a very uncomfortable fact, but not limited to our country. And at the same time, there were enlightened individuals in all of the Western countries, notably among academics, who tried to run rescue missions to bring Jewish scholars to find them at least temporary homes in Canadian, American, and British schools. But the Canadian record wasn't nearly as impressive as the United States and Great Britain in this respect.
But immigration of Jews was being suppressed at a federal level in Canada. Frederick Charles Blair, Director of Immigration, was charged with creating these post-depression restrictions and ensuring that they were followed. Blair was a known anti-Semite and a staunch bureaucrat who thought Canada was in danger of being, as he put it, flooded with Jews. And for him, the term refugee was synonymous with Jew. In 1939, Prime Minister Mackenzie King was under significant pressure to intervene in a specific situation where Jewish refugees were being denied access to Canada. He forwarded the matter to Blair to review the situation. This was the case of the ill-fated MS St. Louis, a ship of approximately 900 Jewish refugees from Germany. They were being refused asylum, first from Cuba, then from the U.S., en route back to Europe. Blair's response was that the refugees did not meet the criteria for immigration. Blair also warned that if Canada allowed them in, they would likely be followed by other shiploads. The line must be drawn somewhere. Eventually, the ship sailed back to Europe, and deals were brokered with Britain, France, Belgium, and the Netherlands. Although all but one of the passengers that made it to Britain survived, almost half of the refugees that landed on the European continent did not survive the impending Holocaust. During the Second World War, Japanese-Canadian communities were the focus of intense and severe racism throughout the country, notably in the province of British Columbia. From the beginnings of Japanese immigration to Canada, racism was prominent from the government and wider public. This discrimination grew tremendously after Japan's attack on December 7, 1941, on Pearl Harbor. Many within the local population and government of British Columbia felt that they were under immediate threat from the Japanese citizens during the Second World War. With the Canadian government's declaration of war against the nation of Japan, a policy of forced relocation and detainment was deemed necessary against the Japanese-Canadian community of British Columbia.
There had been intense not just anti-Japanese, but anti-Oriental feeling in the western provinces. Right from the time there were significant numbers of people from the Far East in the late 19th century. So that one of the formative events in the development of politics and immigration policy in Canada were anti-Japanese riots in Vancouver in 1907. And interestingly enough, the federal official who had the responsibility for trying to clean up that mess was the young William Lyon Mackenzie King. The sensitivity of British Columbia was always in the back of his mind. And the ugly fact is that in 1941 and early 1942, the federal government could see no reason to displace the Japanese on the West Coast. But it was feeling in the province that forced it on the government. And I think one of the most effective explanations is that King remembered the intensity of the 1907 riots. And I don't think it's not window dressing when King said he authorized the removal of Japanese from the West Coast in the end to protect them against the virulent anti-Japanese feeling on the West Coast.
All peoples of Japanese ancestry were removed from their homes and taken to internment camps. They could only bring what they could carry, around 150 pounds per adult and 75 pounds per child. And therefore, many had no choice but to leave important belongings behind. The living conditions in the camps were appalling and dangerous. Letters and mail were censored and restricted, and a key aspect of Japanese culture, higher education, was not available. They were stripped of their rights, classified as enemy aliens, and even by the end of the war, threatened with further discrimination and expulsion. In a final blow, the proceeds from the sale of their goods and possessions would be used to pay for the living expenses of those interned.
The displacement of the Japanese took place under the War Measures Act, which in fact gave absolute and total power to the federal government to do anything to anybody in any way it wanted. It was absolute authority. Even during the war, some of the displaced Japanese were beginning to start lawsuits against the government, questioning the justice of what had been done to them. And in Canada, the crown was supreme. So there's nothing you can do when you have an absolute power, and I'm afraid those are the ugly facts.
Another group of people who were treated in a colonial manner were the First Nations.
The Aboriginal peoples were in a rather unusual situation in that they were really in a colonial status under the federal Department of Indian Affairs.
They lived largely in segregated communities on reservations, which were removed from the rest of settled Canadians. The marginalization of the First Nations was a contributing factor to the racism that developed towards them. This also hindered the Canadian government's goal of trying to assimilate them into more advanced Euro-Canadian cultural values and social norms to remove their cultural uniqueness. First Nation support during the Second World War was appreciated by the larger Canadian population and offered an opportunity to prove their worth and remove some of the racism that existed. However, during the course of the Second World War, the Canadian government enacted conscription, which they disliked because they believed there were already ample First Nation volunteers. In addition, elements of their treaties with Canada allowed First Nations not to get involved in Canadian wars unless they wanted to, and some did not.
Within the armed forces, in fact, once you were in, you were tended to be treated as equals. The problem was everything was filtered through the Department of Indian Affairs, and that put the Aboriginal population at a double disadvantage. First, they were, at least the reserve population, was scattered in well, they're still isolated communities, so they aren't getting full information. And then, especially after the war, this meant that with veterans' benefits, the veterans' benefits were administered through Indian Affairs in remote communities that had almost no communications, so that the Aboriginal people did not know what their rights were, what they were entitled to. So the special problems that faced the Aboriginals was the fact they were really in a colonial existence within the Canadian state.
After the war, the First Nations felt like their efforts had gone unnoticed, and they did not fully understand their rights and what they were entitled to as veterans of the war. Meanwhile, the discrimination against them persisted. As a result of their eventual efforts, the First Nations did get recognition and compensation, but not until 2008. The level of discrimination that faced the First Nations people did improve from before and during the war in the aftermath, and their efforts in support of the war did help pave the way for the recognition they deserved to become appreciated as true Canadian citizens. In a war for freedom, it is unfortunate that the record shows Canada was guilty of violating freedoms of minorities within its own borders. This period marks a chilling chapter of intolerance and discrimination in Canadian history. Although Canada has made significant progress in the area of equality, it is important to remember our history as it truly was.